Very simply, very little water is needed. No tilling is needed. Very little weeding and things that you kind of always have to weed when you're growing vegetables and stuff. But we're going to demonstrate how to produce one of these. First of all, we dig a pit like this. And the reason it's the size that it is, about 2 spade widths wide, about 2 spade widths deep. So when we do mound this up, the whole thing will be no more than about 4 feet wide so that you can reach everything from one side or another, just like your raised beds. And you don't ever want to step on it. You compact the soil, you don't want to do that. So that's why we do it in this kind of configuration. Now I've made a smiley face. These are kind of on contour. You want on contour to catch water as it runs. This is very flat and it's hard to even find contour where we are right here. But there is little bits of contour on just about everybody's property. So if this was uphill and I am downhill, this smiley face here catches water as it runs and it falls down in here. And that's what we want. That's part of the permanent part without having to feed and water your garden all the time, constantly every morning and all of that. So without much ado, we start out, one of the principles, Mary, mm-hmm. big stuff? Mm-hmm. Start grabbing some big stuff?
Yep.
How we start, dig all the way down. If you have any fresh manure or green grass clippings or anything green and new and alive, that kind of needs to go in the bottom. Always put that in the bottom. If you have horse manure or something that's fairly fresh, it's very hot and it's actually quite dangerous to put vegetables on fresh like that. It's very hot, and when they break down, they use up a lot of nitrogen and a lot of different elements. So you put all that stuff down in the bottom. So now we start throwing big stuff in. The big stuff does big old decaying has mycelium and moss and all kinds of stuff on it already. This is all good stuff. We're emulating what happens in the forest and in the wild. Trees fall, everything falls, and it just goes and it goes and it starts building soil, and everything grows like crazy, and you never have to see, you know, you never have to water, you never have to do anything to it. So we put big stuff down in here. And the big stuff also creates little cavities for different kind of organisms to find in there. More importantly, and then it slowly decomposes, more importantly, it acts as a sponge, these big logs. And you can put oak, lots of different varying varieties of trees and stuff like that. Big stuff is great. Alder, fallen down, it sponges up and holds moisture. And that's a bonus. And then when everything is soft like it is, because we've dug, and it's one reason we till, so roots can grow and go unimpeded. So that's why we dig and do this like this. So the root systems for everything we plant on this have a chance to go as deep as that, and then some. By the time they get down here, they're a hardy plant, and they're ready to just send their roots anywhere. So this is the point. The work is right now, is digging this and out. But it's not any different than having to till or having to build a box and fill it full of dirt. It's actually less work. In Florida, it's very easy, to dig. So we start out with some big stuff, is that about half?
Yeah.
So then we start putting this stuff in. We also start doing our activator, our compost, manures. This is worm castings and tons of worms and lots of lovely stuff in there. And there's red wigglers all in here. This is crazy stuff. Just a little bit of this. This is kind of an activator. And I'm going to put a couple of shovelfuls of really high-end stuff that you can even buy the black cow or something like that. Whatever you buy, or any kind of really hot loaded compost or anything that you want.
And what does activator mean?
Activator, it's
it helps to break down.
Yeah.
The
loaded with all of the different microorganisms. Worms, there's lots of stuff growing in here. So if you're bug squeamish, this is not the kind of stuff you want to get your hands and fingers on. And just a little bit of a layer everywhere. And it kind of gets things started. activator, for the most part. And we'll put this other one in this other. And the point is we're fast, again, we're fast tracking what happens in nature to make it easy on us in the future. So now we pack this thing full of more sticks, more things that'll break down, loaded with nutrients and all of that, and spongy stuff that'll hold moisture and decompose and settle in and become soil, as opposed to Florida, it's all just sand. But there's more in here than just sand. There's lots of minerals and stuff in here. But we need to add biomatter. So this is all downed, dead, nothing really green. And then we kind of keep it fairly neat too. Mm-hmm. And we just pile all this stuff in here. And then we start putting the soil back. It's kind of that simple.
So when did you get some
concrete? Oh yeah. Again, now's the time to put different kinds of, and you see this is just, you know, those are oak leaves. Variety is good too. Cedar's not the greatest thing in there, kind of antimicrobial. Not a lot of citrus in your compost. Antimicrobial, little bits. Onions are antimicrobial, little bits of those things are okay, but not if you're juicing, throw a whole big pile of grapefruit juice in there. So that's kind of what we do, and then shovels. Yep, we just slowly, and we're gonna put some comfrey and a couple of other things, some yarrow. We've got yarrow, and right behind us is a great thing to grow. This is called comfrey. An old world kind of, and you don't have to be gentle with this stuff, it will grow back. So we take it and cut it. The thing about this particular plant, it's a perennial, it goes all the time. It sends a taproot way down in the ground and grabs minerals and different elements and iron and phosphorus and all these things and brings them up and makes them available in their leaves to the other plants that need it. And even these trees can't go deep enough. So we break this stuff down and toss it in here. Again, this is about as much feeding as you'll ever do. Instead of fertilizing, that's what we're doing. This is green manure, green fertilizer. So we throw this stuff in here, and there's really no rhyme or reason, just kind of spread it out a little bit, because this is going to be a mound and everything's going to kind of work together. And it doesn't take a whole lot. Then we're gonna put a little bit more stuff in there. And then we're gonna throw all this back in there. And then we're gonna cover it and then plant. And one of the things about permaculture, everything is linked together by perennial plants. Trees, rosemary is a lovely thing to put in here, something that's gonna last all the time, you know, forever. Fruit trees, that's a Chickasaw plum right behind you. That's a great thing to put on one end.
That's a native
and
plant.
So you link everything together, tie everything together, because those guys are perennials, will live for years and years and decades. They will send root systems out and down and anchor everything in together. So then when you put your annuals in here, we have kale and cilantro, and I think collard greens, I can't tell. A brassica they all look like when they're tiny. Those annuals go down there and the perennials help them and give them all kinds of nutrients that they need as they're sending roots down. So that's the point. Everything is anchored by perennial flowers even. Doesn't matter. You get it in there for those root systems too. And they keep erosion. They do lots of different things. And then you put in your quick herbs, your tomatoes, cucumbers, all of that kind of stuff in here. And they are fed by the whole system, the complete system. Permanent, you know, it's a permanent thing.
Are you using this just for kitchen gardens, or are you doing fields like this? This is just a kitchen garden, or a...
This particular, yeah, something small like this is a kitchen garden. There are people around the planet that are trying to feed millions of people by doing this.
Well, even us over at Edgewood Garden.
Edgewood Garden, I'm cooking for 50 tomorrow, so, and we feed 50 people with all the sweet potatoes. I picked them all this morning.
Yeah, we have a garden out there. We have a lot of hugels out there. We've got all sorts of perennials and annuals.
About a half acre. We've got about 34 trees. I counted them the other day.
Is that the Florida Christian Apartments?
Yeah.
Right off of Edgewood?
Yeah.
So you can, instead of one farmer feeding 10,000, which is the average, it used to be one farmer fed, you know, 75 or 500, way back when our grandparents were doing everything. So that's kind of the permanent part of it too. Everybody grows a little bit of something. And there are countries, and in China, I know they're putting together one of the largest food forest, is one of the terms that you'll hear in the future. Food forest. Different layers. You have your weeds starting out and then coming up into some annuals and flowers, and then shrubbery, blueberries, and different things, blackberries, all that kind of stuff, into your trees. So you create a food forest that constantly feeds and shades. You have trees facing on the south side, so in the summer this gets a little bit of shade. So it's not quite so harsh, because the summer's a killer in the summer. Everybody knows that. Anybody try to grow tomatoes in June, you just can't do it. And it's a heartbreaking thing here in Florida. But that's probably enough. Another thing on these mounds, if you do this in your house, don't mound them up too high because of the heat and the sun in the summer, and it will dry it up. We've made that mistake at Edgewood Gardens. We have some mounds that are this high. They're very dry on top. So about this much, and if you have any questions on how to fill this guy? And then anything green too, the grass that you cut in here, I like to put this on the bottom, but I always like to put that in there kind of upside down. Because anytime green stuff, grass, anything, new clippings, when they decompose, they use nitrogen to decompose. And they use other things to decompose. And they take a lot of nutrients out of, if you're trying to grow right now. So kind of turn them upside down. The first cut, when you're cutting this out, I tried to put them in the front so I could put them in first. And then we start piling this up, which we will. Anybody want to grab a shovel? No? Not quite as interactive as us. But I do want to kick the grass in there first. Kind of maybe turn it over a little bit.
The roots are trying to go down to that.
Just to keep that grass from coming back. Because grass is tenacious, nobody.
I might have missed the first part, but you have a compost. And where do you put the compost in soil? On the top layer?
New fresh stuff that's kind of very green kind of wants to go on the bottom. If you have older ready to mix in with soil, if you were going to pot with it already and it's already black and very close, now that can go on top. You can mix that in with all of this nothing but sand. Now that's a good thing to just start layering in, which that's the goal. The green stuff is easy. We have a lot of, you can acquire a lot of that. You can chop and drop a bunch of things too. Grass clippings and all that can go in the bottom. Green, really green manures. Yeah, the weeds and all that go on the bottom, because then they'll die. They don't have a chance to, right?
And sometimes
really fresh manures need to go on the bottom because it's too hot.
Sometimes
they need to age.
Oh, I'm sorry. Sometimes I'll clean out my refrigerator when I'm doing one at home.
Yeah.
And everything goes on the bottom. So.
Yeah.
What about the fresh wood chips?
Wood chips on the bottom. Because fresh wood chips are going to, again, they're gonna require nutrient, like this, all this stuff. These piles of wood chips on the other side of the farm here, which is this stuff, this pathway.
Right.
Use it as pathway. When it dries out, this is whole tree, these wood chips. They're taking all this and running it through the... through the thing. That is beautiful stuff in about a year.
Okay.
And then anything and everything wants to grow in it. Because it becomes exactly what this is. It becomes soil. And then everything wants to grow in your pathways. So wood chips, very green wood chips, again, green needs to go in the bottom.
Okay.
If you have some old that's brittle and all that, you can use it as top dressing. We're going to use hay as our top dressing because it's readily available. Pumpkin patches everywhere. We get a whole bunch of that stuff. But that's pretty much.
So
then you can start layering different things in this sand, because this is very sandy stuff.
How long until you can start planting things on top of it?
Directly, right now.
Oh, okay.
As soon as we're done. We're gonna put hay on it first, because we have some very small things. and I don't want the hay to lay it down. So we'll lay the hay down and then make a little pocket and put our, these are all annuals, cilantro, and some two different kinds of kale sitting there.
What kinds of perennials are you going to put in here?
And we don't have any. I'll just show you, I'm kind of beholden to the farm here.
Right.
But lemongrass, this is lemongrass over here. This is a nice thing to anchor one side. Beautiful. When it grows crazy, you just come in here, give it like a little flat top, and that kind of keeps it going. And lemongrass is lovely for Thai cooking, for fruit salads, put a little bit of lemongrass.
So maybe a fruit tree on one side and lemongrass on the other?
Lemongrass on the other. Mm-hmm. There's all kinds of...
There's all sorts of herbs.
Yeah, there's all kinds of herbs.
Flowers.
Sage and rosemary are dry loving, so you can put them kind of on the middle and the top. There's another big clump of grass.
One thing is, once you get in permaculture, you find out there's all sorts of plants out there you've never heard of.
Yeah, so that's the confusing part. Is it seems like it takes a lot of knowledge at the beginning to know what to pair with what.
It doesn't. You don't have to pair. Now, the pairings and group, everything is a companion to everything else. It can be.
Right.
So paying attention to that at first, it still confuses me. It's way overwhelming. Companion planting, forget that terminology.
Okay.
A good thing to put in here, especially this time of year, are onions and garlic. This is the time of year for them, November. You plant onions and garlic in November. It'll be June before you pull garlic out. But it's a lovely thing to keep pests away. It keeps grasses from growing in. Grasses don't like to come up too close to onions. Lots of other things do, but at least you're eliminating a couple of little things. Flowers are good, like marigolds. They keep different pests away, and they work like a champ. Put a marigold in between your brassicas, in between your collards and your broccoli or something. Fantastic. Anything. And they keep the bugs off of those few plants. You know.
Have you heard of the permaculture, Jess?
Yeah.
Group?
Yeah.
Well, there's that, but if you join the Facebook page, there's all sorts of, everybody, you know, ask questions, other people are always helping out.
Thank you, that's super.
Thanks.
Yeah, there's a lot of, there actually are quite a few groups.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which area of town are you in?
Better.
Okay, you're in my area then. Yeah, because this Permaculture Jacks meetup is actually second Thursday of the month every, right off of McDonald's, so it takes less than 2 minutes to get there.
I don't know why I thought this would be more interactive. I thought I'd have four people out here with shovels, and my back is killing me. I'd be out here just talking, but. And you have to kind of pile it up at first, because of course everything will settle, and you don't want a hole.
Right.
But you don't want a mound either. About maybe a foot high, tops.
Yeah.
Here in Florida, and it will. These guys started out. Right behind you is a Hugel mound that is leveled out, and is doing very well. They don't. These guys are farmers. They don't have time for this garden here.
And so then what you do is you just keep replanting annuals, but you leave the perennials.
Yes.
Leave the perennials. I didn't even get to that.
Yeah.
Try to, anything you don't need, you don't want, the bugs are eating, chop and drop, let it fall.
Right.
It only looks unsightly for a short period of time. This is about as bad as it gets when you have a ton of tomato vines that just kind of die. Now this is the kind of stuff that you just want to chop it down and let it fall.
Right.
And then plant in between it. Just come in here and plant another for the winter, a winter vegetable.
And do you need to rotate, like not have tomatoes the same, like
uniform? Think about that a little bit. I do that a little bit. Everybody kind of does that. So your brassicas in a place 1 year, the next year a little bit different.
Right.
Then put your I don't really know how that goes, the nightshades and things. But the way that we grow, we never grow this many mustards at once.
Right.
This is all Mizuna mustard. I would never grow 5 or 6 big mustard plants like this. I would have maybe 2 or 3 and then lots of other things in between here. Because as it is, this is kind of a mini smorgasbord for disease and bugs. And they use this for chickens. So always mix things up. There's bok choy in here. There's kale, this is a brassica. There's kale in here somewhere. So they have tried to do that. but they just can't get out here.
Yeah.
So they tried to do that a little bit to kind of mix it up.
But you wouldn't put like tomatoes in there too.
Well, different seasons.
Yeah.
Tomatoes are spring and summer.
Sure.
Well, not summer. Mizunas are a brassica. It's an Asian variety, but it's a mustard green. So that's all winter. And so, yeah, you kind of alternate. So where you have tomatoes and nightshades now,
yeah,
do a sweet potato patch the next season, for instance.
Okay.
For the next, and sweet potatoes, by the way, are 8-9 months out of the year here.
Okay.
The vines and the leaves will freeze. They're getting ready to come up. But in March, back come the sweet potatoes. And I just picked 25-30 pounds this morning.
When do you plant sweet potatoes?
Whenever you want.
When I toss mine out because they've gotten too old, that's what I do.
It really is. Whenever they start growing slips.
And you can eat the greens.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. Sweet potatoes, like I said, the leaves and the vines will freeze. Okay. So don't plant them. Don't plant any now.
Right, got it.
And plant again in probably March or April. Okay. And then all through the season up until Christmas. Well, I mean up until probably a month ago.
Until October.
Yeah, if you did about October. Yeah, if your soil is fairly soft and all of that, they'll do very well.
And can you keep planting them like
constantly?
Okay, so we can keep planting them in the same place. The tomato, like we had some problems with nematodes, so I'm scared of them.
Yeah.
We can keep planting in the same place.
Sweet potato. Well, that's what we say. Kind of swap the pattern out.
Okay.
So this this trellis here,
yeah,
next spring, right, probably do a bunch of peas, green beans. And then bring the tomatoes and stake them out in
Got
different
it.
Places.
Okay.
And the same with sweet potatoes or anything else.
Okay.
We do regular potatoes.
Okay.
So in the, right. So
and
then you just
potatoes,
put a little bit something different there.
Right. Sweet potatoes and regular potatoes are not related, right?
They are not.
Okay. So you can plant them on top of each other.
You can.
Okay.
Now they will compete for ground space.
Yeah, no, I mean 1 year in the next year.
1 year in the next year.
Okay.
Sure.
Great. Thank you. You're a wealth of information.
Well, great. Thanks. Swing back by in a few minutes and you'll see what this kind of looks like finished.